John Keim, who covers the Commanders for ESPN. You can read his work at ESPN.com. Hey, John.
What up, fellas?
So let's start with Sam. Six games in, we were talking about it. If you looked at QBR, he's 20th in the NFL. You look at pass rating, he's 15th. He's got 9 touchdowns, 6 picks. How would you evaluate him yesterday and through 6 games?
So, all right, so yesterday I felt like early in the game he was a little bit more decisive. I thought that first third down throw to Curtis Samuel was just a nice job there, right? I mean, big conversion, good throw, decisive bullet. I think he's done, you know, I think he's, when he's decisive, man, it comes out of there fast, which is, I guess, why he's decisive. So I like that. And I like the ability to incorporate his legs on some plays, like the 4th-and-1, really good job there. The throw to Curtis Samuel for the touchdown, just a good decision because it was the right decision because just the matchup there, zone, but Alford was the slot and he can get beat on those kind of, route, I would say. So I thought he was pretty good. The second half then, there were times where it's just like you get into that habit of just holding it too long. Now, I think what you have to do, like for me, go back and see, okay, what can, because sometimes you think that he holds it too long, and I do believe that's the case, and he admits that, and they all say that. And I think that's part of the learning curve. It's also something he did a lot in college because he knew that he could make plays with his legs. And I think the hard part here is sometimes I wonder if, you know, in the past in college, you could slip out of a situation. But here you're having a hard time like squeezing through a certain gap and Calais Campbell's the guy's getting you versus some guy from Florida State, right? Mm-hmm. So, you know, I think that's something he definitely has to improve on to take that step and get rid of the ball a little bit more and avoid those hits and sacks because they just add up. Yeah. I mean, I don't know how you can survive that over the long haul as tough and, you know, he's bounced backable, I guess, for lack of a better word, he is. So that's an area where he definitely has to improve. And, you know, obviously sometimes you can see certain things every game. Say, oh, he could have done this. He could have stuck with this a little bit longer. He could have done this. I think that's part of the learning curve. But I think I would say this overall, I think he's been about what I expected because I liked him coming in because of the traits he has. And I think he's doing about what you could hope for. And yeah, there are areas of growth, and I go back to, like, yeah, he holds the ball a little bit longer, but I think, you know, then you need to give him a situation where it's hard, but, you know, then it certainly in the future, you have to build a situation for him where he maybe gets that extra half second that he needs, right? Because it's just hard right now for him with that, and that's where he's getting all those sacks. But overall, yeah. I mean, I think – overall, I think he's done what you could hope for right now.
Yeah, I think he's been pretty darn good. I mean, the sacks are annoying.
Yeah, no, I like him.
Yeah, the sacks are a little annoying, but I will say this. I think it was two of the sacks were actually better than incompletions because he kept the clock running.
Yeah.
You know, and so I don't know if he did that consciously. I'm guessing he probably didn't, but it worked out. I do have two time management questions, though. I mean, Ron talks about attention to details. Okay, buddy, here's two attention to details. There's 3 minutes and about 16 seconds left, and Sam needs to run. I think you're just trying to run clock at that point. It's third and long. Why are we snapping it with 7 seconds left on the play clock, right? Bring that down.
That's a good question, yeah.
That, and then the punt with 15 seconds left on the play clock. Like, we got to be better than that.
And I think that's a very good point. And yes, I don't think there's any argument there at all. I would agree. And finishing on Sam, too, I also think he's very mature.
Yeah.
And I think that's going to serve him very well. Like, when you hear him answer some questions after a game, you're like, oh, my God, the kid's only 23, and he talks like he's been in the league sometimes for 10 years. And you know, I don't think it's lip service for him when he talks about accountability or what he could do.
No, he's a real deal.
He's a humble kid. That's why I liked him coming in because I think there are a lot of traits that you can build on as a quarterback. And, you know, obviously a lot of things to learn, but, you know, seven games in now for him, the starter. But there's a lot. There's definitely a lot to like. Now, the question I always have is, how high can he go? And but that's something we'll see as the season goes on.
We'll see. But I tell you what, you'd rather have him than a lot of young quarterbacks out there taking a lot higher than him.
Correct. Yeah. Correct. Absolutely. I mean, you know, I think, I agree. I definitely agree with that. And, I mean, he's still, like, right now, I mean, he's their best. It hasn't been a high bar, but he's their best quarterback since Cousins left.
Hey,
I would put, like, you know, with Alex Smith was a different kind of quarterback for them, and if he had stayed healthy, it's a different conversation.
Could have been different, right.
Yeah, but and he was a different style. He wasn't as much a pure passer when he was here as much as he was. He just knew how to play.
Mm-hmm. All right, so update us on – I don't think we saw Forbes – unless I missed something.
No.
I don't know if you had any steps.
No, you did not.
Okay, and then Quan Martin got in there. He had two or three tackles. So what's that mean going forward? Obviously, Forbes' struggles over the last few weeks was the reason he was benched, but what's that mean going forward? And then especially when you play the Giants, who don't really have any threats on Sunday in the passing game, could we maybe see him back on Sunday?
I don't know. I think it's going to depend on how he comes out this week because, you know, a lot of the problems that they have wasn't so much that, you gave up this or that. It's why you were giving it up. And unless you fix the why, I don't know, like, you're going to have to be able to trust him. And then you need to make sure that he's better in those areas, like the techniques where your eyes are, how your feet are, et cetera, your leverage, all those things. Like, if you don't fix that, it doesn't matter if the Giants have a guy who can hurt you or not. They'll find you, you know? And so I think it's when he's better, a little bit more consistent with some of that, because a lot of the stuff that he struggled with, well, you saw examples, plenty of examples of, like, okay, you did it right here, but you didn't do it right here, you know? So you need to be more consistent and just keep working on that. So I think I don't know what it means going forward yet because I think it's just all going to depend on him and when he gets to that point, whether in practice. And the hard part is, like, well, how are you going to prove it if you're not in the game? But you've got to show it in practice too. And I think that's where it's going to have to start. And the hard part for him, he doesn't play special teams. So, you know, you're going to need him to develop into that. To use an active spot on him, you know, to be able to develop into it. But I mean, the kid is talented. And I will say, like, when you talk to him, he doesn't bristle at anything. He's not sitting there in the locker room hanging his head.
Yeah, how was he yesterday? How was he after the game?
So it was really weird because yesterday we're sitting there talking to Danny Johnson as he is dressing right next to him. Mm-hmm. But it wasn't like a solemn, you know, glum face or anything like that. You know, you saw him, like, a couple times you saw him kind of joking around with a couple teammates, and because you look for that, like, how does a kid handle that? And you know, when he's had the bad games, he sat in his locker and talked to us. He'll talk to you in the open locker room. I mean, that's part of their job, but I've been around long enough to know some guys bristle at that, or they might make themselves unavailable, and he hasn't, and he'll answer the question. So I like that part of it. I think he's not hiding from anything. He understands that, like, as a freshman, he struggled at times too. He had to go through some things. It's a cornerback's life. And Danny Johnson sitting there talking, you know, funny thing is Danny goes out there, has a, you know, big play, knocks the play, pass away. He's always been that in a case of emergency break glass kind of guy for them. And he did a nice job. And he's sitting there talking about, you know, Emmanuel's going to figure it out. He'll be back in there soon. I'm like, yeah, but that's your job you're talking about. But he knows. And so they know. And it was kind of a weird juxtaposition, but I didn't see any, like, it wasn't like Emmanuel sitting there dressing as fast as he can and getting out of there. He was hanging around with teammates just like I think he normally would.
Mm-hmm. John, I was just looking at the sack totals by team, and the Commanders are fifth in the NFL, but it just doesn't seem like they're pressuring the quarterback consistently. What's your read on that?
Yeah, I saw that. Well, because the first couple of games they had 10 sacks. So, you know, some of it's built on that, definitely. I think it's been a little bit surprising, the up and down. I mean, you're not going to get 5 sacks every game, but, you know, can you get more consistent pressure? And I think one thing I will say, like, yesterday they started to get that, and the Falcons were – the one thing I want to go back and check, too, is how many times have teams run, like, play action? How many times are they using, you know, heavy boxes or you know, heavy protection schemes to offset some of that? Because Buffalo did that very well. I know, like, Atlanta yesterday, heavy play action, a lot of boots, and they start, you know, with the boots in the second half, or they weren't working because they were able to, they had athleticism at the ends. You know, Casey Tuhill was a good athlete, you know, Montez, those guys, like, you have that and you're able to, you know, they were able to defeat those, right? Because of that. But that's one way to defeat pressure is by using all those kind of actions. And so I'd be curious to go back and listen, they have to, then it's on them. If you have a one-on-one to win, and you know, if you have 5-6, you know, you're going to have Payne or Allen is going to be double teamed, and that's also going to hurt that. But I don't want to make excuses for them. But when you look for answers, those are some of the things you see. And then it's like, okay, you know, at some point it's like, all right, you guys, are the alpha males out here, go hunt. Right. And so I don't have a great answer other than I think there are things that teams do because of that. And to be honest, knowing that there are going to be holes in the secondary at times too. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, you can get that. For example, like Montez Sweat, his first couple sacks this year, those took a while to happen. Like the first one, I think, I want to say was more than 3 seconds. And the second one was like around 4 seconds, mm-hmm. which means coverage. Mm-hmm. And that's, you know, are you getting those coverage sacks? Because like when Howell's getting sacked, sometimes there's, you know, you're taking your first option away, and then it's a little bit of a struggle, and you're taking your check down away, and it's a little bit of a struggle. And so it becomes, you know, he holds it longer, but it's also a coverage sack too. So, you know, are you getting a lot of those? I haven't seen a lot of those lately.
I didn't know. I've actually always been impressed with Casey Tuhill. He actually always kind of makes plays when given the opportunity. I didn't know he had that kind of burst and close, though. Like
that's why they like him.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I didn't know that.
And one of the reasons, you know, that they've always liked him is and like last year in the past, when they use some of those packages, and you want to that single package, the 5 D-line package is essentially a 3-4 look. Mm-hmm. So in those kind of situations, you need to have guys who can be a little bit more athletic and drop them in coverage to maybe run some sort of blitz action or overload or just pressure package with them dropping, because that's what you do in a 3-4. And so that's what it is. And so that's one reason they liked him was because of that he can do that and play in space a little bit, enough to make those packages work. But yeah, the change in direction is really good, but that's, you know, and I think sometimes you don't always see it as a rusher. First of all, he's not in there all the time. Mm-hmm. Secondly, there's going to be a lot of maybe more bull rushing rather than just trying to get around the corner to keep guys contained. So that may be why you haven't seen enough. But like in open field, like he's good change of direction. He's a good athlete, and that's why he's out there. And that's why like last year when it wasn't Sweat and Young and you had him and then James Smith Williams, you had two guys who are a little bit different in what they do, and they both could be effective in what they do.
JK, do you think that the defense, just looking at the numbers, they gave up 12 more first downs than Washington. Washington's offense didn't do much in the second half, so the defense was out there a lot. But you look at the total yardage, 402 to 193. The 3 turnovers, obviously the difference in the game. But do you think the defense as a whole played better?
Against the run, they were very good, and that was their intent. Yeah. And, you know, it's funny because thinking about it, and like, not plugging my podcast, but I do these keys to the game, and one of them is, of course, and this is an obvious one, make Desmond Ridder beat you. And that's what they tried. That's what they did. They put him in a situation where he had to win the game because they were stopping the run with that, again, the 5 defensive line front, which a lot of times is good for pressure because, again, you get one-on-ones, but it looked like, and you know, here's the other thing, like I'm going back this morning, it's like, okay, what do you want to watch first? Well, I'm going to watch the defensive plays. There's freaking 79 defensive plays.
A lot of them.
Yep. Half the day watching the defense. But, like, they did a really good job, it looked like, filling gaps to defend the run. And I think it has to start there for them. And then they put Ridder in position where he had to make some plays. And they made enough plays because, again, you know, the interception in the end zone came because of pressure. He has to throw it quick. Jamin Davis makes a play. Who was the other one? I'm forgetting the other. Oh, Kendall.
Kendall
makes a good read and a good break on a ball. So, you know, that's what you wanted to do. Put him in position where, you know, yeah, you're going to give some stuff up, and you give up too much stuff, and it makes you wonder, well, if you're facing a better quarterback, how does it look? Well, you weren't, you know, so that's how it looked. And, you know, you had to stop the run. And because if you let Bijan Robinson win that, you know, take over, then it's going to be an even longer day. I mean, they controlled the ball. It was 35 minutes. Now, part of that, they had two short fields for touchdowns.
Yeah, true.
And so that adds to it. But I thought they did a really good job defending the run. And so then you have, like, this week, you have Saquon Barkley. I mean, you know, you have to stop the run, and you're going to have to make some plays in the pass game. Their coverage needs to be shored up, and there's no doubt about that. But if they can't stop the run, then it'll be a wrap.
Mm-hmm.
All right, John. Good stuff as always. That's John Keim. You can catch his work at ESPN.com. Thanks, pal.
Thanks, guys.
Thank you, JK.